For those of you who might not know, I just finished my first semester of law school, and I didn't think that the law had driven me insane enough, so now I'm going to take some time and examine it within my favorite series of all time. My favorite season of Game of Thrones is the fourth. I think the third is probably better as a package, but the fourth has always been special in my heart. And the main backbone of this dramatic fourth season for me is the trial of Tyrion Lannister following the death of King Joffrey Baratheon. It contains some of the most iconic scenes of the entire series, most notably Tyrion's speech after his trial, for which Peter Dinklage won an Emmy, and the trial by combat between Oberyn Martell and the Mountain. These are fantastic scenes that I love in both book and show, and I thought that given that legal systems are such a kind of staple of this chapter of the story and of other parts of the story going forward, it would be interesting to examine their history and role in the present and future of stories in Westeros. So, today, join me as we get into some legal systems in this fantasy world. The idea for this video did not spring forth from my head fully formed like Athena from the skull of Zeus. It took some time, and initially I had this as a kind of an examination of the office of Master of Laws. That's a position on the small council of the king, and I thought it could be quite an interesting one. There are some interesting characters who have filled this office, but upon looking at the history of this supposedly illustrious position, we do not have a single accomplishment or thing that any Master of Laws has ever done in the history of Westeros. They are on the King's Council. They are quote-unquote in charge of administering justice. We don't know anything about anything that any Master of Laws has ever done, and we've seen a fair few of them come and go throughout the main series. Renly was a Master of Laws at the start of the books. He's followed by several other characters, ending with, I believe, Randall Tarly at the end of A Dance with Dragons, the beginning of The Winds of Winter, and we have seen zero accomplishments from any of them in the main series or in the history books that we have. That's not to say that there aren't any interesting characters that have held this office. I already mentioned a couple who exist in the main series, but the main one that comes to mind for me, and I'm sure for you, is Lord Lyonel Strong, the Master of Laws and later Hand of the King from House of the Dragon and Fire and Blood. He's a really interesting character. In the books, he's described as someone who appears to be fairly kind of slow and methodical and not really on the level of other players of the Game of Thrones, but he did spend a lot of time at the Citadel and is a very learned and wise man. I genuinely think that at least based on his appearance in House of the Dragon, he is probably the best and most honest counselor we have seen in the entirety of the series. I think that Ned was probably around that level of honest in his counseling of Robert, but I also think that Lyonel Strong had a bit more kind of shrewdness to him than Ned Stark did. I think that he was a bit more pragmatic and had the better interest of the realm as a whole in mind rather than Ned's sort of stoic ideals of honor as they should be upheld in kind of a vacuum without considering any of the actual realities of governance, as I think Lyonel Strong did a very good job of doing that. And honestly, he was one of my favorite characters in the first season of House of the Dragon. Of course, we do have another Master of Laws appear later in House of the Dragon. Lord Jasper Wilde attends the Green Council and serves as Master of Laws after Lord Lyonel Strong is appointed Hand of the King and later killed by either his son or whoever did it in the books. Lord Jasper Wilde is also called Ironrod, which is supposedly, according to Septon Eucist, derived from his unflinching attitudes regarding any legal matters and systems of justice. However, according to Mushroom, who is always to be believed, this is known for another reason. He's called Ironrod because of certain other qualities that he may possess that I'm not going to discuss that also has to do with the fact that he allegedly sired 29 children on 4 wives before the last of them, quote, died from exhaustion. Before we get further into the video, the system of laws here on Quinn the GM YouTube channel says you have to subscribe and like the video if you want. Please, I would really appreciate it. Please, thank you. The fact that we have no accomplishments of any of the Master of Laws is something of a trend in terms of Martin's writing regarding any subjects of the law in this world, as we really do not have a lot in terms of the actual systems of governance and laws in Westeros. There are a few specific laws. I think there are actually 6 we have on the books, and that's about it, other than generic don't kill, don't steal, and stuff like that. In addition to that, we really don't know much about their actual systems of how the law is maintained and ruled out. It seems to be fairly based on feudal systems that existed in medieval England. However, there are other systems that existed at the same time that aren't present in Ice and Fire. Specifically, things like the Magna Carta and other systems of balancing the power of the governing and the governed existed 200 years before the area of English history upon which the Song of Ice and Fire is based. Specifically, Magna Carta was created in 1215, I believe it was, if Chuck McGill is to be believed. And the War of the Roses takes place towards the end of the 1400s. So about 2.5 centuries take place between this more advanced system of governance appearing in England and the events upon which Game of Thrones is very loosely based. Let's now take a look at a few of the specific laws that do exist within A Song of Ice and Fire. The first of these that we hear about from Ned's perspective in A Game of Thrones comes from the first ruler of a unified Westeros minus Dorne. Aegon the Conqueror ruled that the king is the supreme law of the land, and that any individual, house, or area that goes to war without the king's leave will be branded a rebel and swiftly arrested and executed for treason. This is something we see come into effect a number of times, as most of the first and second book involves a lot of individuals declaring war either on the crown or on each other. There are a couple other laws from this early period of Westeros dealing with domestic violence that I'm not going to discuss, both for fear of demonetization and for not really wanting to, those being called the Rule of Six and Rule of Thumb, and being established by Queen Rhaenys Targaryen, the first queen of Westeros, alongside Visenya Targaryen. We then arrive at King Maegor's laws, which are very important to the original series. Specifically, Maegor's laws dictate that any member of the faith is forbidden from taking up arms. They cannot carry any weapons, and thus cannot form an army. If you know anything about the history of Westeros, you know that Maegor's rule was plagued by members of the faith trying to tear down the Targaryen dynasty, and a large part of what Maegor did that created a lasting impact on his descendants, or not descendants, his nephews and nieces were the ones who carried it on, not his direct descendants. But specifically, these laws forbid any of these people from taking up arms against the Targaryens again, and this is part of why they've been able to hold on to power for so long, as there haven't been any religious movements that have been allowed to be armed on Westeros since the time of Maegor. However, once we arrive at the main series, call these laws Tommen Baratheon, because they are going directly out the window. Cersei Lannister does away with King Maegor's laws in exchange for the debt the crown has incurred by the faith being completely forgiven and allowing her to build a bunch of fancy new ships that will not get stolen by a pirate king. This is, I think, one of the dumbest moves in the entire series, if not the dumbest, and it leads to a massive religious uprising, as well as Cersei's imprisonment and a massive shift in the status quo in King's Landing. We will get back to this circumstance a little later, as I think there is a lot to say about it in relation to the laws of Westeros itself. The final two laws we have in the books for Westeros come from the greatest queen that the continent has ever seen. Alysanne Targaryen did a lot to improve the station of both the common folk and women in Westeros just as a whole, specifically focusing on the rights of widows and abolishing the right to the first knight that was previously established to be something that all lords held. We now arrive at trials, and this is one of the areas where I think Westeros' system of laws fails the most, or at least makes the least sense. Trials or disputes of any kind are overseen by whatever lord is ruling in the area. Lords take disputes to higher lords, and those higher lords take those disputes to the king. Overall, this system seems very, very easy to back up if there are a lot of disputes, and frankly, it seems strange that this system is able to exist for so long. 300 years is a very long time to just have continual disputes being solved by lords and not having really any negative responses to it. There aren't very many peasant uprising or lower lord uprisings that might be existing in response to any disputes regarding the rulings on any trials by lords and ladies. This is also something that really just doesn't make a ton of sense to me, given the fact that there are so many other systems of law that existed at this point in our modern history. However, it just doesn't seem to have developed in such a way in Westeros. Specifically, by this point, we had systems of common law springing up in places, that being courts that kind of exist onto themselves, and trials acting as precedents for future trials to create a source of ease for future rulings. This both clears up future disputes and prevents anger at those actually making the rulings, as precedent can be a good way to kind of deflect blame. Of course, if we're talking about trials in Westeros, we need to talk about the most iconic kind of trial in Westeros, that being a trial by combat. We see two in the main series so far, those being Tyrion against Lysa Arryn and Tyrion against Cersei, in book 1 and book 3 respectively. This essentially allows a knight or a nobleman to send their fate to the gods, to say that, oh, this champion is going to fight on my behalf, and they're going to prove that I am favored by the gods to win, and thus I am innocent. It is a fairly strange system, as only two of the gods really seem to deal with justice or fighting, that being the father and the warrior. But overall, it does seem to exist as a way to relieve nobility and knights from responsibility for their actions. Specifically, it's a kind of a workaround that really any other individual, any commoner on Westeros, would not be able to use to the full extent as anybody in a higher position of privilege. There are similar things in the modern world. There aren't trials by combat, but there are certainly a number of ways in which people in power or people with wealth are able to circumvent the consequences of certain actions. I am going to talk a little bit about the sixth season of the television show here. There's something that I initially really didn't like, but looking at the world building of Westeros, I kind of do like, but I still don't like how it was done. Let me explain. In the sixth season, Tommen and the High Sparrow outlaw trials by combat. This is a massive anticlimax because we all thought we were going to get to see Bob Muscles in action. We were going to get to see Cersei defend herself in a trial by combat against the Faith, which would have been so cool. It also would have been Cleganebowl. It would have been great. It would have been awesome. But it does really make sense that this populist movement would want to go away with this kind of method of trials that really only favors nobles. It's framed in the show that, oh, the Pope really doesn't want Cersei to have this trial by combat because we know that Robert Strong is better than any champion that the Faith could call because he's a zombie and also the biggest person on the planet. But overall, I think that it does kind of make sense in a broad sense. I said sense twice there, in terms of the actual motivations of this movement of common folks in trying to decrease the power of the ruling class. It does very much make sense, and I could see it as a direction that the books could take as well, though hopefully better framed or set up than it was in the show, albeit I do think it is still quite likely that Cersei's trial by combat will happen in the book. It is worth noting, specifically to Cersei's trial by combat, that the champion of a member of the royal family must be a Kingsguard, which is remarkable given the fact that both Marjorie and Cersei are soon going on trial, and the Kingsguard of late have been dropping like flies. The only ones that remain in King's Landing are Boris Blount and, I believe, Robert Strong. Loras Tyrell might be nearby and uninjured, but we really don't know, as Baelin Swan has gone to Dorne and Jaime is chilling in the Riverlands, maybe getting killed by Stoneheart. The final system of laws is one of the most important in this setting, that being inheritance. Inheritance is vital in this medieval system, as all of a lord's possessions, titles, and holdings are passed typically to his eldest son. If there's not a son, it is typically passed to a daughter or the oldest available male relative. It is interesting to see all of the disputes that appear in the series over succession. It is probably the most common form of law to appear in the series, but it is something that there isn't a ton of specific precedent on, at least in specific cases, as people refer to it. A lot of people think that succession for kings is very much set in stone, especially around the time of the Dance of the Dragons. There's a lot of argument that, oh, Aegon's a guy, he should obviously be the king, but it does ignore the fact that there's only been one peaceful succession of power prior to Viserys' own ascension, as the succession between Aenys and Maegor was hostile, the succession between Maegor and Jaehaerys was hostile, and overall it was just appointing heirs pretty much all the way down until we get the Dance of the Dragons. So what do you think of the system of laws as they exist in Westeros? Do you think there are ways it could be improved? Pretty obviously. How do you want to see it develop in the Winds of Winter? How do you think it'll develop in the Winds of Winter? I'd love to hear your thoughts, and I'm excited to make many more videos in the near future. I apologize for my week's hiatus. As I said, I was doing law school finals, but those are done now. I'm on a bit of a winter break, and I'm going to hopefully do an uptick with videos, and I have some great ideas that I am very excited to bring you in the near future. So if you enjoyed, be sure to leave a like and subscribe, comment all that stuff as well. I really appreciate any support of the channel. It really helps me out, and it just feels good to feel supported and all that. So yeah, thank you so much for watching, and I hope you have a great rest of your day. See you soon.